Hello, hello, hello. How are we doing today? My name is Spectrum Dominus, and I will be your predictor this evening. Today, we're going to do a Royal Rumble 2017 prediction show. Sit back and enjoy it. We are filming live, so a lot of the discussion I'm having will be with the chat on my stream at twitch.tv/SpectrumDominus. You can come check us out. We do a lot of wrestling stuff there. I'll be using a lot of graphics to show you where my mindset is going as we go forward and why I'm making the predictions I am. I have a very general idea of what I think is going to happen, but you're going to see me actually talk it out and make my final predictions as I don't have them written down and exact hard in stone yet. I predict that I myself am going to be surprised at a few of my predictions once I start talking it out. So sit around, sit back, enjoy. This should be fun. To the stream, thank you guys for being here. It's good to see you. And so let's get started. Royal Rumble 2017. Now, there's some easy things and some very difficult things about this year's Royal Rumble. About every year's Royal Rumble, when you think about it. The most important thing, whether it be about the Royal Rumble match itself, or whether you're talking about the championship matches, and I think especially this year, the two world title matches and the Royal Rumble, it's very important to understand where WWE is going for WrestleMania. The matches prior to the world matches don't play in as much. I believe that I can make predictions for the other five or six matches that there are without really thinking too much about WrestleMania. And that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to start out predicting the matches up to the world title matches. And then the focus of the stream of the video is going to change a little once we hit those world title matches. So, I want you to know that I'm using a form here for the matches. Right here, you can see it. I brought it up for you. And you can check in stream right now. The Reddit link that my mods have posted in the chat is where you can find this. Reddit user ALLKOREV. Has posted this, made this, and he likes to get it around. He's asked to spread it around, so I'm using it in the video just so you guys can and see and jump to it. There will be a link to this Reddit in the into this Reddit PDF in the comments below, in the description below, and this is what I'm going to be using for the match part of the. The discussion of the matches. Now, I'm going to take the full list down to just the match list like this. And this shows you the matches that are in the Royal Rumble. Hey, Cocoon, how you doing? So, the first match on the list is Sasha Banks versus Nia Jax. It is like the Tag Team Championship, a pre-show match. I believe the six-woman tag team match might also be a pre-show match. I believe there's three, but I may be mistaken in that. But Sasha Banks versus Nia Jax is an... Well, they're all interesting matches in a way. But Sasha versus Nia is going to be a situation where... The reason why it is difficult to predict is... Nia hasn't beat anyone yet. They want her to be a beast. They did the whole Braun Strowman start with her, where she destroyed nobodies. And even this past week on Raw, she fought another jobber so she could get a win. But the only match she's had two matches, both versus Bayley. She beat Bayley in the first one, but that was only because Bayley was injured or something along those lines. It was done in a way that it was obvious Nia was going to win. There was outside interference. It wasn't a clean win. And then she fought Bayley for the number one contendership and lost. So I feel like although they're ready to build up Naya to be this beast, they're not ready to give her wins over major talents. They don't want her to be pinning Bayley or Sasha or Charlotte. They're okay with her pinning Alicia Fox. They're okay with her pinning the lower talent. But I don't see them giving her a pin win over Sasha, at least not clean. And I notice that on this Reddit forum, it's one of the points is it a pin, submission, or disqualification? And then the next one is it a clean finish? So when picking, when predicting this outcome, it's either Sasha wins or Nia Jax wins, but it's not a clean finish. And that's why they included that option, because it's obvious that for Nia to win, it's got to be a non-clean finish. I feel like with the whole buildup of Sasha's injury and Sasha losing the last match to Charlotte, the way they built this up, if they're leading towards what is rumored going into WrestleMania, this is the perfect time to give Nia a win. Let her win by pin, but let her win unclean by pin with outside interference, whether it be, Dana Brooke or Charlotte or someone coming down, which doesn't make much sense, or just the ref gets distracted and someone gets hit with it with something. I don't know how. I don't have a solution for the unclean finish. What I have is I don't see Nia beating Sasha cleanly, but I also don't see Sasha winning this. A Sasha win here ends the feud and doesn't have her anywhere to go. Charlotte and Bayley are going to be going for a little while before they make that into a big everybody is involved. So I feel like Nia wins this with an unclean finish is how I go. If Sasha does win it, it's by DQ. Nia gets herself disqualified by beating up Sasha too much. And that's how I see that going. But for my official, I'm going to say Nia Jax takes the win here. Second match is the Raw Tag Team Championship match. You see Cesaro and Sheamus versus Gallows and Anderson. This match, they've been booking Anderson and Gallows very strong, which is good because they really dropped the ball with them early on. I am not a huge Gallows and Anderson fan, but I know a lot of people are. I know a lot of people wish for them to be booked stronger. And they deserve to be booked stronger. They are the top heel tag team on Raw. That's not saying much. There's the tag team division, although infinitely better than it was 2 years ago, is still the weakest part of all of WWE. So it's good that they're booking them strong. That being said, with the dusty finish that happened, they don't necessarily need to have them lose here to make them, I should say, they don't have to need to have them win here to make them look strong. Cesaro and Sheamus just got the belts, and having them lose the belts that quickly after New Day's year plus reign, I mean they had those belts for what, a year and 2 months or something, that 400 something days. So it was quite a bit longer than a year even. And then when Cesaro and Sheamus took it from him, first of all, I was a little surprised because I thought that it would have been better for them to drop him here at the Royal Rumble. But to give him to Cesaro and Sheamus, even if Cesaro and Sheamus are a transition tag team, you could hold off just one more month. Fastlane is a month from now, and you can give the belts up then, and it doesn't make the reign seem so bad. Also, I almost feel like they're leading towards a Sheamus-Cesaro Royal Rumble match. So if that's the case, if they're not Royal Rumble, WrestleMania match, and if that is the case, if they're leading towards Sheamus versus Cesaro facing each other again at WrestleMania, because they're not turning Sheamus good, they keep leaving him as a heel with them together. And if they're gonna go back and make that match eight, of the seven series, but they did it by building up their storyline together. I think that having them fight each other again at WrestleMania would be great, but doing it 2 weeks before WrestleMania or 3 weeks before WrestleMania, when Fastlane is, I think that's a better amount of time for that buildup than having them lose here and then having all this time to WrestleMania. So it makes more sense for Cesaro and Sheamus to hold the belts, keep the belts. That being said, it doesn't mean Cesaro and Sheamus win this match. Anytime there's a stipulation, and I've got to give credit to Bryan Zane in Wrestling with Regret, because although I felt this and thought this, it's really him that like nailed it down, watching his videos, that really nailed down the concept of anytime there's a stipulation put in place, anytime there's a stipulation you put in place to stop an event from happening, that event happens anyway. I have my stream over here saying Gallows and Anderson are better, though. You're putting them against two singles wrestlers. That's crap. If you're listening to what I'm saying they need to win this match but not take the belts. They getting the belts at Fastlane and then retaining them at WrestleMania does not do anything bad for them. And then winning this match by disqualification again doesn't hurt their status. You still have them be the top tag team of. Now, I realize we're in 2017, but if you look at the year from WrestleMania is the end point of the story, it's a season of wrestling that starts the day after WrestleMania. This is the 2016 season that ends at WrestleMania. They can be the best team of 2017 by winning the belt shortly before WrestleMania and retaining them to the end of the year or something. You could build them as a great tag team in the Federation and have them battle with Enzo and Kaz through SummerSlam and Survivor Series. But giving it to them now does not do anything more for them, and taking them off Sheamus and Cesaro now only hurts the Sheamus Cesaro feud. So it makes more sense to not give it to them now. Then you put the stipulation in place that says there's two refs so that we don't have this problem. Well, I'm going to allude to the Becky Lynch Alexa Bliss steel cage match that happened this 2 weeks ago on SmackDown, and say the steel cage was put in place to keep La Luchadora from interfering. Yet she interfered. That's what they do. It's a WWE mainstay. You put a stipulation in place to make sure something happens, and yet somehow it happens anyway. There are two refs there, not to make sure Sheamus and Cesaro aren't screwed over, but to make sure Gallows and Anderson aren't screwed over, because they're the ones that won their match but didn't get the belt because Sheamus interfered with the ref or hit the ref. So the dusty finish affected Gallows and Anderson. So the second ref is there to help Gallows and Anderson get the right outcome. And because of that, we're going to see it screw them over anyway. So in this match, either Cesaro Sheamus win by an unclean finish, but more likely they get disqualified again in some way, and Gallows and Anderson win the match but don't get the belts on this night. So I'm essentially saying that Sasha and Naya and Cesaro and Sheamus, those matches kind of end the same way with. And it also goes far to say that these are pre-show matches. You have the title match on the pre-show, very rarely changes hands on a pre-show. I feel like if you were going to put. It's almost like why the Cruiserweight match is on the show and the tag team match is on the pre-show. Because the Cruiserweight's going to change hands. The tag team championships are not. So, the next match on this list is the rest of the women's. I think it's very telling to say that there are three women's matches out of six matches. You have one Cruiserweight match, one tag team championship match. No, I guess that's seven matches. I can't count. I'm only a math teacher. But you have the tag team championship match, no other tag team matches. You have the Cruiserweight match, no other Cruiserweight matches, and then the two world title belt matches. And there are three matches that are not, and really the women's match, there are only two non-title matches, and they're both women's matches. Now, you could argue that the reason this is because it's the Royal Rumble and all the men are in the Royal Rumble, but there are quite a few men that aren't in the Royal Rumble. There are tag teams that are not in the Royal Rumble. There are a lot of people, and we'll go over the Royal Rumble, the people that aren't in it. You could have had a number one contender match between the Vaudevillains, Breezango. You could have done that match, and we've seen it a million times, but you could have done it again. But instead, they decided to give these matches to the women, which is very telling how much they're pushing their women's division, how much they feel they're gaining. And we talk about it a lot on the stream, how much merchandising and that kind of stuff plays in. And I feel that there's a chance, and I haven't checked any numbers, that the women are selling merchandise better than they ever have, which is good. I'm glad to see it. I have my own Becky Lynch shirt and Bailey Bear, and I have quite a few Brie Bella shirts. I wish she wasn't retired, but so I myself partake in the women's wrestling merchandising. I enjoy the women's wrestling now. I didn't necessarily back then, but so I'm glad to see they're getting their time. So we got the six-woman tag match. Alexa Bliss, Mickie James, Natalya, the heels, versus Becky Lynch, Nikki Bella, Naomi, the faces. And I spent a lot more time discussing this today with a friend than I thought I needed. I started by saying, in a match like this, you need to identify who is going to take the pin on each team. If the heels win, then the faces, Naomi's taking the pin. If the faces win, then on the heels, Natalya's taking the pin. But the more we discussed it, the more I realized there's a lot more going on here. So what I did was I said, okay, first of all, let's separate them. Let's figure this out. You have Nikki Bella facing off against Natalya. Their fight is not over here. This is not a fight that ends tonight in a six-man tag match. So they're still paired up after this. So let's just move them into their own group. Then you have Becky Lynch, who's fighting Alexa Bliss for the title, and Mickie James, who just interfered. And then you have Naomi, who has nothing going on. And so that's the situation you have. You have these three, triple threat, but these two are friends, this two, and one by herself. So take that and move it to the side, and we'll think about that in a second. Let's bring Seth Rollins' fight with Kevin Owens into this. Let's discuss that situation that just happened, because that's what I analogized it to. Seth was fighting Kevin Owens for the title, could not win because Chris Jericho got involved. So what did Seth do? He decided, okay, I can't beat Owens for the title until I get rid of Chris Jericho, and he went into a fight for Chris Jericho. Now, that's the storyline reason, but we understand WWE didn't want to keep going Rollins-Owens. They needed a new contender for Owens, so they shifted Rollins to Jericho and created that fight. I believe the same thing is happening here. We've seen Becky Lynch and Alexa Bliss. We've seen it for a while. They're not going to give the belt back to Becky, at least not yet, maybe later down the road. But for now, they're happy with the belt on Alexa Bliss. So they bring in Mickie James, strengthens the women's roster on SmackDown, which, major thumbs up, there was the right move. I agree, we need to get some more women on SmackDown. But if you look at the six-man tag match, all of a sudden, we have six pretty much legitimate women on this SmackDown roster that everyone said was way too weak at the split less than a year ago. So very happy how quickly they built this roster, this women's roster on SmackDown. But if you make Becky now fight Mickey and say that's the two, and you say Nikki and Natalya are not done, well, the champion doesn't have an opponent. Also, when you get a new champion, the first thing you do is make him or her defend the title against the former champion. And then, generally, you make them fight someone that they can beat. Like, a lot of guys win the title, defend against the guy that they won it from, and then face someone like Kane. Kane is a main eventer, but you know he's not going to win the title. It's someone you can feed the champion to build up their reign. I believe that's what's going on here. I believe that Naomi is Alexa Bliss's next opponent. And I believe that Naomi is being fed to Alexa Bliss. Now, it doesn't mean that Alexa is going to beat Naomi clean and easy, but I think that Alexa Bliss takes out Naomi over a course of a couple matches so that she's fed to her. So because of that, I say, how does this play out? Well, all of a sudden, I say Mickie James and Becky Lynch are not involved in the ending. So now we have two different groupings, either Alexa Bliss, Naomi, or Natalya, Nikki. So now, if the faces win, I say Naomi gets a pin on Alexa Bliss, giving her a reason to be the number one contender. She got a pin on the champion. The champion takes a fall. You could blame it on Natalya if you want. Natalya goes to clothesline Naomi. Naomi ducks and she hits Alexa Bliss. Naomi hits Natalya out of the ring and Naomi pins Alexa. You can do whatever you want, but Naomi gets a pin on Alexa, setting up Naomi versus Alexa Bliss at 2 weeks from now at the Elimination Chamber. Or you go the other route and you say the heels are going to win. Natalya pins Nikki Bella for cheating, whatever reasons, however you want to do it. But it gives Natalya a win over Nikki while it's not in a singles match, which gives Natalya more to talk about. See, I beat Nikki. I'm better than Nikki. Why does everyone Nikki this, Nikki that? I can pin Nikki whenever I want. It feeds that feud more. Either way, I thought it was funny that discussing this out, having this conversation, made it where it went from Natalya and Naomi were the pinnies to Natalya and Naomi were the pinners. So I predict that Naomi pins Alexa Bliss, setting up Naomi Alexa Bliss for the Elimination Chamber in 2 weeks. If I'm wrong, then Natalya pins Nikki Bella. That's what I have. But my prediction goes down with Naomi with a pin on Alexa Bliss. And my chat's all, ooh, I like that, you know, stuff like that. So apparently they like that prediction. All right, so now we're on to the main show. That one may have been on the main show. I think I saw that is also on the pre-show. We'll see. I don't think it matters either way. And we have the Cruiserweight Championship, Rich Swann versus Neville. I do not see how they cannot give this to Neville here. To me, this is as close. The next two matches are as close to 100% guarantees as I can give. So I'm not going to spend much time in it. You could say it's too quick to get the belt off of Swann. Anything but Neville dominating Swann is a fail. Neville should pretty much, I mean, obviously you have to make it somewhat of a match. He has to have a spurry. But for the most, what's the word? Anyway, it doesn't matter. He has to have a little segment of where he gets some offense off. But for the most part, Neville should pretty much dominate Swann in this match and take the title. He needs to walk away and be the champion and be the king of that division. If he does not win the title, I mean, you could argue that Neville gets too aggressive and gets himself disqualified. That way, Rich holds on to it for a little longer before Neville takes it. I don't like that. I do not like that at all. Neville is not in there as I am going to destroy everyone. I hate everyone. I don't need the title. He's in there saying, I'm the king and the belt belongs to the king. I own this division. He is goal-oriented Neville, and he wouldn't get himself disqualified. He would keep his eyes on the prize. That's the feel I get. That's the character that's coming off. I don't see any situation where Neville cannot walk away with this belt. It has to happen, in my opinion. And if they don't, then that is as major a fail as you can make with the 205, which is failing on its own. So I also think that 205 is having a lot of trouble and putting it on someone as high profile as Neville, and not that Neville's high profile, but for the 205 guys, he's as high profile as it gets, is much better than trying to have Swann drag it on, because no one really knows Swann. We've discussed this on the stream, and I won't go into it too much here, but there is a certain level, at least at the WWE level, of name recognition that is necessary. You can bring in anyone you want and put a title on them, but if people don't know who they are, then they're going to fail. You have to build a certain amount of recognition for a guy if you want him to succeed. AJ Styles coming into the Royal Rumble last year was great, but I believe that if he won the Royal Rumble last year and you put the belt on him immediately, and you didn't give the WWE fans who did not know him a chance to get to know him, then he's not as successful as he is if he wins it 6 to 8 months later after you got that chance. And I feel that that's what's going on with Swan. You brought in these 205 guys, but no one knows any of them. Kendrick was your best chance of anyone knowing him. And honestly, I believe from a numbers standpoint, 205 did best when Kendrick was champion. I think putting it on Neville helps out 205 in that sense, and they got to do it immediately because they're already discussing whether or not to cut the show. I could see a DQ, someone else come in, Stardust question mark Kappa. Yeah, well, obviously we know Cody Rhodes is not coming in unless they're gonna pull a fake Diesel, fake Razor Ramon, and bring in a fake Stardust. I don't see that happening. But that I expect. I discussed why I don't think a DQ should happen. I do see that they could go that route. It would be a mistake, but we'll see. So next is the Raw's Women's Champion ship. Just like the previous one, I think this one is pretty obvious. I think that Charlotte Flair has to retain here. Bayley already has a couple wins over Charlotte. In fact, she only has one loss to Charlotte, and that was with a cheating Dana Brooks as the referee. I think it's way too easy and obvious to give Bayley the win here, and too early. I think that if you want to drag it all the way out to WrestleMania, then that's fine. If you want to make it happen at Fastlane and then Charlotte's rematch is at WrestleMania, that's fine. The rumor is a four corners match, Charlotte, Bayley, Sasha, Nia at WrestleMania. That's what I'm hearing. I like the concept, I like the idea, and I think that going into that match, Charlotte should be the champion. I think that WrestleMania is where Charlotte's pay-per-view winning streak ends, and where either Bayley or Nia Jax's reign begins. I think that Nia Jax should win it at WrestleMania, but that's a whole nother video. So Charlotte wins here. It could be outside interference, it could be something, it won't be clean. It could be as far going as far as Bayley passes out but refuses to tap if they really want to, build Bayley in that sense as the person who would never give up. But Charlotte definitely wins this. So, exactly. Someone in chat just said the kid next to me at the first episode of 205 Live was very bored, and it was probably because he didn't know anyone. Just to springboard off of that and to try to not extend this video too long. We talk all the time. My viewers ask why I don't watch a lot of independent stuff, and it's mainly because I don't know anyone. I could go turn on Ring of Honor or New Japan, but I don't know anyone, and because I don't know them, I'm not invested in them, and because of that, I have trouble. Because I'm not invested in them as a character or in their stories, I have trouble really caring that much about their matches. And I feel the 205 is having the same problem right now. I am just now starting to get invested in the 205 matches, and that's, 3 months of watching these guys now. I like Jack Gallagher, I like TJ Perkins, I like Brian Kendrick, I like Neville. I could care less about Rich Swann, and the rest of them. But I feel like as I get to know them and what have you, I'm going to care more, and I get more invested the more I care. So, the next match. Okay, so from here we have the championship matches, and this is where we need to really start looking at other stuff. So I'm going to take the match lists down, and we're going to bring up this list. Actually, let's bring up. We're gonna skip the championship matches and talk a little about the Royal Rumble, and then get back into the championship matches. And here's why. This is a list of everyone that's in the Royal Rumble currently. Everyone that's been listed, every Raw participant, every SmackDown participant, and the people that are actually entered. There are 22 current entries into the Royal Rumble. And I realize I skipped the wrestling, the championship matches, but that's because of what I said at the beginning of the video. You have to understand where they're going, or at least have to, in your mind, have a route to WrestleMania to predict these things. Now, everything that's written, everything that comes out of my mouth, everything that happens in this video is my opinion. Now, it may be a fact in some sense as well. It is my opinion that these guys are in the Royal Rumble. It's my opinion that Kofi Kingston will be in the Royal Rumble. It's also a fact by the fact that he's been entered. But that's my opinion. But when you see things that you don't necessarily agree with, like, for example, Raw entrance, Undertaker. I understand that Undertaker is on SmackDown, and I will talk more about this later, but for my opinion, Undertaker is a Raw participant, and you'll understand once I get to that. So I don't want you to say, ah, he made a mistake, Undertaker is a SmackDown participant. You'll understand when I get to it. So, these are the 22 people over here. I need to over here. I don't know my left from my right. It's backwards. Those are the 22, well, actually both sides, but that are in the Royal Rumble. Now, you see two columns there, and the first column says NCIN. And for me, that's no chance in hell. These are the people that I've marked down as no chance in hell of winning the Royal Rumble. Now, there are more people on that list. For example, Big Show has no chance in hell of winning the Royal Rumble. Ziggler has no chance in hell. The Miz has no chance in hell. I can put those people, but they're not in the same category as Mojo Rawley, Luke Harper, Xavier Woods in the no chance in hell. So the ones that are marked are people that are literally fillers. They are literally in there as a filler to get thrown out at some point and possibly create a new fight for them. But they're not... Oh, look at that. You are correct. No chance in Nell. No chance in Nell. You were here while I was setting up. You should have noticed that. So that's what that column means. So anyone that's there, that's listed there, I'm not even worried about. I'm not even going to discuss their chances and what's going on. Okay? So because of that, over here, you need to understand what people are doing at WrestleMania. Now, I'm going to take this list off for a second so that I can slide over and show you that this here actually has more column to it. And that is the No One Cares column. Now, I'm going to quickly fill out the No One Cares column because... And then I'll slide it off because it takes up too much room on the board. But this is what people are doing at WrestleMania. Now, again, you got to remember, these are my opinions. These are based on rumors I heard and what I think they're leading towards from what I've seen. Sometimes I'm taking straight out of the dirt sheets. And sometimes it's like, I think they're setting this up and I think this is how they're going to do it. And no one's really stating that. So when I go through it, Big Kaz, Corbin, Big E, Big Show, Braun Strowman, Bray Wyatt, Brock Lesnar, Cesaro, Chris Jericho, Dean Ambrose, Dolph Ziggler, Goldberg, Kofi Kingston, Luke Harper, Mojo Rawley. No one cares what Mojo Rawley is doing at WrestleMania. We don't know if he'll be in WrestleMania, and we do not care what he's going to be doing at WrestleMania. Now, you could be the biggest Mojo Rawley fan, but what I'm saying is, we know he's not going to be in the main event picture, and us figuring out what he's doing has no bearing on either the Royal Rumble or the main event picture. So we don't need to focus on it here. I'm sure there are Mojo Rawley fans out there. I'm sure Mojo Rawley himself is watching this video going, wait, I care. Yes, I too care. I like Mojo Rawley and I want him to have a WrestleMania match. However, his WrestleMania match has no bearing on the Royal Rumble or WrestleMania main events or the Royal Rumble main events in any way, and thus, for this video, no one cares what he's doing at WrestleMania. Also, so that's it. That's the only no one cares on that list. Now, there's other ones that we'll be filling out, but I guess I could have just put no one cares in his opponent thing. I could have done this. No one cares. Or maybe I should say, doesn't matter. That's a little nicer way to say it. Doesn't matter. Okay. So, there we are. We have Mojo Rawley filled out. So, when we go through this, we can say, WrestleMania opponent. Tag with Enzo. Doesn't necessarily mean he's going to be in a tag match with Enzo, but he's not going to be much higher than that. He'll be fighting his current storyline. He's not going to be fighting for the main event. Baron Corbin. That's a big question mark. We don't know what they have in store for Baron Corbin. What we know is that Baron Corbin is someone that they're pushing towards the main event picture. Could Baron Corbin fight for the WWE championship at WrestleMania? Absolutely, he could. I don't necessarily see it happening, but it could happen. Big E is going to be in something with the tag team. What I'd love to see at WrestleMania is a friendly triple threat match between Big E, Kofi Kingston, and Xavier Woods. I'd love to see a triple threat match where they do a discussion and find out, or maybe Stephanie, trying to mess with him, says one of you guys will get a title shot, and they make them fight each other. But I'd love to see where they say afterwards everything's fine and they stay together, but they face each other at WrestleMania. Because why does it matter? They don't need to be fighting more tag team matches right now. That's the only thing I can see. Big Show's going to be fighting Shaq, Shaquille O'Neal, Braun Strowman. That's another one with, we don't know. We've heard rumored Undertaker. We've heard rumored that they may draw out the Sami Zayn that far. We've heard rumored Goldberg. So there's a lot of things that Braun we need to look into. Bray Wyatt, in my opinion, is fighting Randy Orton at WrestleMania. Now, a lot of people have Orton as the odds-on favorite. In fact, if you go to Vegas, Orton right now is the odds-on favorite to win the Royal Rumble. I don't see that happening. I see him fighting Wyatt. I think that there's two pay-per-views between now and WrestleMania. I think they can do Randy Orton, Luke Harper, and then they can do Randy Orton, and then they'll have 4 to 5 weeks before WrestleMania to set up Randy Orton versus Bray Wyatt. So that's how I see it. You don't set up that story unless you're going to leave Orton for another 6 months into SummerSlam Survivor Series with Wyatt, which I'd love. I'd love for them to draw this out even longer. But the payoff has to be either at WrestleMania or not for another 6 to 8 months. So because of that, I'm going to give the Randy Orton, because I don't think WWE has it in them to draw it out that long. Lesnar gets Goldberg, and that's one of the favorites to win, now getting assigned at WrestleMania an appointment. And that's why we do what we're doing. Cesaro. I have Cesaro facing Sheamus at Royal Rumble, at WrestleMania. I think that we talked a little earlier during the Cesaro-Sheamus match that this is a situation where they can have that eighth match, that final match of the seven series, after building it up, and people will care. No one cared that they were fighting in a best of seven series. And then right around match six, five and six, people started caring because the matches were so good. And then they came out with this great storyline. The payoff for this is the final match of the seven series. To be honest with you, if they do the storyline correctly, that will be a number one contender match for the winner of the of WrestleMania. So WrestleMania happens. You have whatever the WrestleMania main event is for the Universal Championship. And the winner of that gets fed Cesaro or Sheamus, because they're supposed, the winner of the seven series gets a title shot. You make it so that they fight, they break up, and Foley puts them back in a match at WrestleMania, the biggest stage of them all, to see who wins the best of seven series, and the winner gets a world title shot and gets fed to the new champion. That's how I would go about it. That's how I would write it. That's how I think they're going, except for maybe feeding the champion. I think they face off in that final match. Jericho, in my opinion, gets Kevin Owens. This goes back to understanding that the season is ending at WrestleMania. And there is a storyline that always happens from the beginning of the day after WrestleMania until WrestleMania. Last year, people were upset that Roman Reigns fought for the championship at WrestleMania and won his title. But what I preached to these people, to my viewers, were this is the season finale, and this whole season has been Roman trying to get the belt, and when he did get the belt, instantly losing it. Whether it be instantly losing it to Sheamus or instantly... He got the belt and would lose it within less than a month because of Triple H. And the whole season was written as Roman versus Triple H, Roman trying to get the belt. So the end of that storyline is Roman winning the belt from Triple H. It's what the season was written for. If you go any other route, you just spent a year telling a story and didn't do the payoff. And that's what you had to do. Right now, the longest telling storyline in WWE, the storyline that has been going on for the longest, are Seth Rollins, Triple H. Now, they're not doing it from week to week, but Seth Rollins has wanted Triple H since Kevin Owens won the belt. And the one that's going on even a little longer than that is Kevin Owens, Chris Jericho, best friends, because they were best friends right before Kevin Owens won the title. So from that standpoint, this is the storyline that has to pay off on Cesaro versus Shaq. Cesaro versus Shaq. I don't see. I didn't. Oh, are you saying because I went SH, it said Shaq automatically? Okay. I gotcha. It did it perfectly up there. It's fine. Unless it's somewhere else that I don't see it. So this is the storyline that has to pay out at WrestleMania, in my opinion. And because of that, Jericho face Kevin Owens. So you go down to Dean Ambrose, and I'm going to put, don't know, but he's an Intercontinental Champion. So ladder match, which we've seen, ladder match for the Intercontinental Championship. For that, I also see that as a possibility for Baron Corbin to be in that ladder match, along with Dolph Ziggler, along with The Miz. I see all of them in that ladder match. Now, could one of them be fighting for the title? Yeah, absolutely. You could have one of them. Heck, you could make one of them the champion. You could have the pay-per-view in 2 weeks be AJ Styles versus John Cena versus Miz, Baron Corbin, Dean Ambrose. You can have that be the Elimination Chamber and let Miz walk away with the championship and let someone else fight him at the paper at WrestleMania. Now, I don't think they're going to do that at all. I think that all these guys, they think of mid-carders, and I think that if you do a ladder match where it's Baron Corbin, Dean Ambrose, Dolph Ziggler, that group of people, You let Baron Corbin win it, and you give him his first singles title, and he's the Intercontinental Champion. I think that's a good way to go. I feel like they want to push him higher, but the crowd's not really getting behind him. So giving him doesn't have to be a lengthy title reign, but a dominant title reign coming out of a ladder match at WrestleMania, I think that's a great idea. Someone's saying Corbin needs more than being thrown a ladder match with a bunch of guys. I see what you're saying, but unless your plan is to say AJ fights someone else, John Cena is the champion, and he defends against Baron Corbin at WrestleMania, unless that's what you're going to do, there's nothing else to give Corbin. There's nothing else he can do. The only other thing he can do is you could say he enters the Andre the Giant Battle Royal for 2 years in a row so he can win it again. I think that's a step down from winning the ladder match. So unless you're going to put him in a match against John Cena at WrestleMania, which is a possibility, but even with that possibility, he doesn't need to win the Royal Rumble to do that. I feel like having him be the final person John Cena beats in the Elimination Chamber, and then John Cena is the champion, and there's ways to go about it without giving him a Royal Rumble. I think that they're not going to go that high. I think that they have something slightly more higher profile than John Cena. John Cena was originally rumored for The Undertaker, and thus, even though they're talking about that being not the thing now, they, first of all, I believe WWE starts rumors now to get us thinking the other way. I think that starting the rumor of Undertaker not fighting John Cena and rumors of his other opponents might just be to surprise us more when he does fight John Cena. That's a possibility. But even if they don't, to take John Cena away from Undertaker and give him to Baron Corbin is not good at all, I don't think. So that's where I have a problem with that. I'm not saying he wins the Rumble, but maybe eliminates Taker or something and sets it up. Again, not a bad idea, Taker versus Corbin. But can Corbin carry a match? Because most of the times at this point, the matches Corbin's are in, he's doing a good job, but is being carried by his opponent, Dolph Ziggler. You know, think of his matches. His matches are more carried by his opponents until Corbin gets strong enough at the end to plant them in the ground and pin them. Do you really want to stick Taker at this point in his career against someone who's not going to carry him? Also, as we go farther into this video, you'll see the plans I have for Taker at WrestleMania. I think they're, well, not specifically, but I do have plans for Taker at WrestleMania, and thus I don't see that happening for Corbin. I really think that Corbin, best case scenario, fights John Cena for the championship and most likely is in the ladder match and possibly wins it. Dolph Ziggler, I see the same thing, probably the ladder match. I guess in theory, with his new heel thing, they could build him up for quite a few, for 2 or 3 months here, and let him fight Cena at WrestleMania as the main opponent. I don't see that happening. I think he's more ladder match material. Goldberg gets Brock Lesnar. Kofi Kingston, like I said, it's part of the tag team. For me, the only thing that is worth doing for them, and I'll just do that right now for Xavier. The only thing that's worth doing for them is that triple threat I talked about, but they'll come up with something else. They won't do that. Luke Harper, maybe in the ladder match as well. Doesn't really matter. You know what? Doesn't matter. He's not going to be in the main event. Randy Orton. Okay, so now we're getting into things. Bray Wyatt is who I have him facing, but again, Randy Orton is the number one Vegas choice to win the Royal Rumble. Rusev is one of my favorite options. I would love for them to give it to Rusev. It is not going to happen, though. They are not going to hand Rusev a Royal Rumble win. And if they did, that means he'd have to face a heel at WrestleMania. I mean, he'd have to face a face at WrestleMania, which would mean we'd get Rusev, John Cena for the second year in a row. That's not going to happen. Unless they put the belt on Dean Ambrose in the Elimination Chamber, which, again, isn't going to happen. So Rusev doesn't have a chance of winning. I don't know what he has at WrestleMania. For me, what he has at WrestleMania is Kurt Angle. That's what he has at WrestleMania. Now, I hear all sorts of rumors where if Kurt fights at WrestleMania, he wants AJ Styles. That's a possibility. I can see that. That's a great way to get the belt off AJ and put him into a match with AJ, Kurt Angle. I hear they want Kurt to fight someone he's familiar with, so something like a Samoa Joe Kurt Angle. I heard that Kurt Undertaker, which I don't think they're going to do that. So there's rumors and speculation, but I'd love to see American hero Kurt Angle go against Rusev, one of the best workers in the company right now. And honestly, I would have never taken the U.S. belt off of Rusev. I would have had him had it the whole time, never given it to Roman, never went to Jericho. You could have put it on Jericho after the fact, but I would have had Rusev fight go and do an open challenge at WrestleMania and have Kurt Angle answer it and win the title. That's what I would have done. But that's a whole nother story. Then we have Sami Zayn. Again, this is another guy that's not going to be... he's not going to win the Royal Rumble, but he's kind of like the outside chance. He's the last person on the list of, I guess maybe they could give it to him. Could be the title thing you were talking about. I could see Kofi in the ladder match. He has always been good in those kind of matches. And I see that too, Oval. My thing about that is I hate the idea of doing Kofi in the ladder match and Xavier and Big E in a tag team match again. And that's probably what's going to happen. It's probably going to be Kofi in the ladder match with those guys, Xavier and Big E in a tag match, in a four-corner match for the world titles. That seems to be what they do every year. It's what they did last year. I would much rather see them in their own thing, triple threat, winner gets an intercontinental title match, or something like that. But we'll see. So Sammy, I don't know what he has at WrestleMania. He's not going to get Kevin Owens again, which is the story I wanted to build to, but I understand why they didn't. I don't think they drag out Braun Strowman that long. So Sami Zayn is a question mark. He's on the wrong show. Maybe they go with the that's when they transfer him over to SmackDown and put him in the ladder match. Maybe they have something else planned. I don't know. But this is another question mark. And the thing is, the important thing is the question marks are the ones that are potential Royal Rumble winners. That's how you got to look at this. Goldberg fighting Brock Lesnar. Is Goldberg going to win? Do I want Goldberg to win? Absolutely. Is Goldberg going to win? No. Goldberg's not going to win. Why? Because Brock's not the champion. And although they could theoretically, at Fastlane, put the title on Brock and make it Brock versus Goldberg for the championship, there's no reason to do that. That match is big enough itself without having to include the belt. Let the belt boost a different match. So the question marks are the ones that are more likely to win the Royal Rumble. Sheamus, I have him fighting Cesaro. The Miz, I feel like the ladder match, or theoretically he could end up versus John Cena for the title, I guess, but I expect bigger things for him. The Undertaker, this one's a question mark, but it's a question mark in a different sense, and we'll talk about it as we go forward. So this is important to know. These are the things you need to know. Because when you bring up this list of the entrants, you can go Big Cass. Well, first of all, it's not going to happen. We'll do a rating. We can do a... I can rank the no, not going to happens later. But for now, let's just put zero in not going to happen. He's a zero. Big E is no chance in hell. So that's not going to happen. Not applicable. Big Show, not going to happen. Braun Strowman, he's this one we need to rank. Brock Lesnar, not going to happen. But we need to rank him just because. Cesaro, not even an option. Chris Jericho, we got to rank him. Goldberg, we got to rank him. Kofi Kingston, not. Rusev, not going to happen. Sami Zayn, we need to rank him. Sheamus, not going to happen. Undertaker, we need to rank him. Xavier Woods, not going to happen. Corbin, we need to rank him. Bray Wyatt, we need to rank him. Dean Ambrose, we need to rank him. Ziggler, we need to rank him. Luke Harper, not going to happen. Mojo Rawley, not going to happen. Randy Orton, we need to rank. Miz, we need to rank. So now this is where we are in that. Now, we need to remember that we've moved past the championship matches because we don't have the information yet. So let's real quickly look at who potentially could be facing John Cena and AJ Styles at WrestleMania. Based on what we have here, the people that we are seriously ranking, which one of these could face John Cena or AJ Styles? So, Cena? I don't know either. Cena, Styles, Cena, And then these are all Raw, so they're not going to fight either of those. So we're showing four Cena, one Styles, and two Ethers. Anyone who can win the Royal Rumble will be facing Cena, unless it's Dean Ambrose or Randy Orton with a face turn, is going to be facing Cena. Now, Randy Orton could win and stay heel as part of Bray Wyatt, and it could be Bray Wyatt's Randy Orton versus Cena. But when you look at it from that standpoint, you got to say, Cena is going into WrestleMania with the title. Now, there's also something else to note. This right here is to note. You don't know what that is. That could be anyone, which we'll talk about in a moment. Now, up here, let's do Roman Reigns and Owens. Strowman, Roman, Brock. I guess because they fought last year, and because people, the rumor was Brock Owens for a while, but he's kind of playing, well, let's say either, he's kind of playing a heel right now. Jericho, Owen, Goldberg, would have to, again, that could be either, but they've already kind of set up, we're going to do either, Sammy would be Owens, Taker, either. So the Raw is a little bit less cut and dry. There's too many Ethers. There's two Owens, one Roman, and three Ethers. So it's a lot less cut and dry. So here's the thing. To understand further, we need to figure out who's going here. Okay? So we need to look at the potential list. Now, some people will say you're missing some people on the potential list. Could be Titus O'Neil or Breezango or you know, people like that could be also in this Royal Rumble. Well, here's the thing. We have talked and said that we seriously, come on. Why isn't it not sort from this selection, alphabetical order? Oh, I see what's going on. Sorry, guys. A little technical difficulty there. Got it now. So they may say these people could be in the Royal Rumble, but we got to remember that the discussion we're having is based on my opinions. And my opinion is, in the world that I live in, these people are not in the Royal Rumble. And the reason these people are not in the Royal Rumble is because they fought a match to be in the Royal Rumble and lost. Breezango, Curt Hawkins, Heath Slater, Rhino, The Ascension, and the Vaudevillains all fought in that match that Mojo Rawley won. So why did they have to fight in the match if they get in the Royal Rumble? Seth Rollins fought Sami Zayn and the winner got that spot. Sami's in, Rollins is out, and Titus fought all three members of the New Day to get in. And because they fought in and if they fought to get in and lost, they are not in the Royal in my eyes. Now, could they end up in the Royal Rumble because WWE says Shane McMahon doesn't get to run Raw if he loses and then he does anyway? Absolutely, they could totally put him in. But in the world I'm living in, they stick to their word, and these people cannot be in the Royal Rumble. This stuff shouldn't have even been here. So, these people are not in the Royal Rumble in my world. And we're going to leave it at that. And we're going to work with the potential. And let's talk about the potentials. There are 8 spots, and we have, 17 names here. So, we have Apollo Crews, Bobby Roode, Enzo Amore, Finn Balor, these are alphabetically. James, you'll notice everything's alphabetically because I don't want to be like, I'm giving away my information because of the order I listed them in. James Ellsworth, Kenny Omega, Kurt Angle, Samoa Joe, Shaquille O'Neal, Shawn Michaels, Shinsuke Nakamura, Roman Reigns, Kevin Owens, John Cena, AJ Styles, Triple H, and Ty Dillinger. Now, could there be someone that is not on their list? Absolutely. If right now, on the phone, Stone Cold Steve Austin called up Vince McMahon and said, "Hey, Vince, my neck's feeling good. Let me be in the Rumble this year." He'll say, "Fuck yeah, let's do it." And he'll boot out whichever Kurt Hawkins landed in this spot. That's the case. So, but these are the ones that either are have not lost a match to get in the Royal Rumble and are still on the roster, or have rumored and given some reason through rumors or whatever, speculations, that they might be. And I'll go through real quick what they are. Apollo Crews is in a battle with Dolph Ziggler, who's in the Royal Rumble, and he's not lost the match. He's probably going to be in. Bobby Roode. Now, here's the thing. As we're speaking, we are a half an hour from NXT TakeOver starting. And tonight, Bobby Roode is fighting for the NXT Championship. He may win that championship and stay in NXT. He may lose that championship and stay in NXT. If he wins that championship, I give him a very small chance to the note of next to nothing of being in the Royal Rumble. However, if he loses and he's staying in NXT, I give him a 20 to 25% chance of being in the Royal Rumble. If he loses and is now coming up to the main roster, I give him an 85, 90% chance. It depends on whether they're going to drag out Nakamura's Bobby Roode for 3 or 4 matches. If they're going to give Roode a NXT championship eventually, or if they're just going to have him bide his time before bringing him up. Roode could very easily be this year's AJ Styles. I believe he comes up. I believe that music hits glorious, the best music currently in WWE. And I believe that that music hits and people go wild like they did for AJ. Now, Roode is not as known as AJ is. And AJ was in Orlando when he came out, which is where he lived 10 years of his career in TNA. But Bobby Roode, based on his music and the love of the NXT crowd, would get near as big of a pop. So that is a possibility based on what happens tonight at NXT TakeOver. Enzo, I don't like if he's in the Royal Rumble. I hope he's not, based on the fact that Kaz said, "I'm in the Royal Rumble." And Enzo stood right next to him not saying that he was too, not saying, all he did was like say, "Yeah, Kaz is going to win it." I don't like that. And then Enzo showing up. However, they just don't even think about it. The fact that there are 8 spots available. Why are there so many spots available? Sure, it would make sense that 2 spots are available because we know this person's going to surprise us, or this person's going to surprise us, or 2 of these 4, but they're not going to be 8 surprises. But the reason they leave so much open, the reason why they don't tell us a Cruz is going to be there, the reason why they don't tell us Enzo is going to be in there, is because, like I said, they may have 4 or 5 of these picked out, and then Stone Cold calls up and says, "Hey, let me be in the Royal Rumble." That's my Stone Cold impression, I guess. And Vince is not gonna say, "Oh, you know what? Kind of full. Sorry. Next year, maybe. All right." No, he's gonna say, "Good. We didn't put Enzo in. Put Stone Cold in Enzo's. Leave Enzo off." And that's why they don't do this stuff. So, do I think Enzo can be in there? Absolutely. When they finalize the 1 injury return and the 2-3 surprises, and they figure out, okay, the total number of non-surprise entrants are 4. What do we have left? Well, what we have left is Apollo Crews, Enzo Amore, James Ellsworth. Okay, good. Put them in. That's fine. That works for me. We still need a spot. Okay, grab one of the Breezango and stick them in there. That's how I feel that works. They left 8 spots open, so they have room to play. Cruz is probably going to be in there. Enzo may or may not be in there, depending on how much room they have. Balor is doing everything in his power to make his fans understand that he is not ready. He is not ready. He's put it all over everything he can do and say and preach. Just like Chris Jericho when he's surprise returning, posts on Instagram a picture of him showing up in Portland, even though Raw is in Boston, and then he shows up on Raw in Boston. I believe Balor is ready. I believe Balor will be in the Royal Rumble. I believe of all the people on this list, the person most likely to be in the Royal Rumble is Finn Balor. I believe that here, Finn Balor is number 23. Not number 23 specifically, but he's in that in the Rumble. I believe that to be 100% true. I believe that WWE and the stars of WWE will play games on social media and interviews and stuff like that to make it so that you're more surprised. Balor, to me, is a near lock. Ellsworth, I feel, is the first person of the non-surprise entrants that will make it. They'll fill it out. They'll say, Finn Balor, Samoa Joe, Kurt Angle, Stone Cold Steve Austin. How many spots do we have left? Only one. Okay, that's James Ellsworth. If there's two, then it's James Ellsworth and Apollo Crews. But James Ellsworth, with the Carmella thing, with them giving him time on TV for storyline, he's going to be in the Royal Rumble. He's probably going to get fed to Braun Strowman. I would not be 100% surprised if the first two entrants are James Ellsworth and Braun Strowman. That would be funny. They're going to use James Ellsworth, I believe. But he's on the potentials list only because he didn't get announced for the Royal Rumble. Next name is Kenny Omega. Kenny Omega has officially stated that he is re-signing with New Japan Pro Wrestling. I spent some time doing the research and looking it up. Sounds like all this is true, and everyone believes that there's zero chance that Kenny Omega is going to be in the Royal Rumble. His name is on this list mainly because he was rumored. Also, his name is on this list because he's supposedly signing that contract in the middle of February. I don't know. I feel like that could be something that he's faking or lying about. That could be something. Now, people that know Kenny Omega and that are more invested in New Japan might say, oh no, he would never do that to his fans. He would never say, I'm coming back and then not come back. That's a good possibility. That's most likely. I believe that's how it works. But I feel like the chance, it's a small chance. It's a very small chance. But the chance that he said that because everyone knows he's going to be in the Royal Rumble at this point, because that's everyone realized it. If he's getting the big payday from WWE, that he could say that. And then when his WWE career is over, he could go to New Japan and say, well, I'm set for life money-wise. I'll come back if you're not too upset that I said this, but I had to do it. There's a small chance Kenny Omega could be in. I haven't written it off yet because he does not sign that contract until February. It is not an official contract. Heck, for all we know, he'll sign a month-long contract, go to the SmackDown brand, fight in the Royal Rumble, fight at the Elimination Chamber pay-per-view, and then go off to New Japan. We don't know what WWE will do. There's a possibility of anything. So, Kenny Omega is a possibility. Kurt Angle's on there for obvious reasons. Hall of Fame, I'm going. Woo! Going to the Hall of Fame. See Kurt Angle inducted. Everything that I've read states he's not, every interview he said, he's not going to be in the Royal Rumble. Hopefully, he says, we'll get something worked out. I'd like to wrestle, maybe WrestleMania. There's no way we can get the physicals done in time. It's just not even something we've discussed. They're not talking to me about it. That could be true, or again, like with Finn Balor, like with Kenny Omega, that could totally be a lie, and Kurt Angle could come out to a huge ovation at the Royal Rumble. If I'm doing that, then you could do the Rusev thing. Have Rusev in the ring, having eliminated everyone, Rusev Mashka, feed him one or two people in a row, and then have Kurt Angle's music hit, and have Kurt Angle throw out Rusev, setting up Rusev Kurt Angle without the surprise at the WrestleMania. That's how I would do it. That could be good. It's a small chance. I do believe that he's not going to be in the Royal Rumble, and it's tough to put Kurt Angle in the Royal Rumble and then not have him win it. But he's not going to win it. So that's I don't think that's going to happen. I've changed my mind. I hope Ellsworth eliminates Taker like Maven that one year and gets destroyed. I want the ending of the pay-per-view to be Undertaker, the final four are there before number 30 comes out, and Undertaker eliminates the other three, and the clock ticks down, and it's just Taker standing in the ring with one person left, number 30 coming, and it's going to be either Taker or whoever's number 30. And because you know, and the setup is what it is, you know it's going to be someone big and surprise, and some Kurt Angle's music's about to hit or something, and then it's James Ellsworth, and James Ellsworth comes down to the ring to the Taker, and Taker just kind of like picks him up and throws him over for the win. That's the ending that we need to have. But anyway, obviously that's a joke. But let's get back to where we were. Samoa Joe. I believe that Samoa Joe is the second most likely person to be in the Royal Rumble. Finn Balor, number one, as the injury returns. Samoa Joe as the surprise NXT call-up. I believe that those are both almost locks in this situation. I think Samoa Joe is going to do well. I do not think Samoa Joe is going to win. There is a lot of talk, and Vegas has Samoa Joe pretty high on their list as Samoa Joe comes in, wins the Royal Rumble, faces John Cena at WrestleMania for the belt, or faces AJ Styles at WrestleMania for the belt. Either way can work, but John Cena, because he's the face, is what they're talking. I think AJ Styles would be a better match because they have that history, but that would be awful. I know it'd be awful. I'm just messing with you guys. But then they were talking about Ellsworth, not Samoa Joe. But I don't see a world, and we're closer to that world, because I don't see a world where Finn Balor comes in and wins the Universal title when he did. And he did. And I think that was a mistake, but they're kind of feeding those things now. So I don't generally see a world where Samoa Joe wins the Royal Rumble on his first night. And I don't think we're quite there yet. But it's getting closer to maybe being a world at some point. Shaquille O'Neal could be in it to help build the WrestleMania. There has been a little bit of rumors there. You have to have some build-up for WrestleMania. Shaquille O'Neal eliminating the Big Show would put that match on people's radar. I think there's a decent chance. I don't know, but I think that there's a decent chance that Shaquille O'Neal is in the Royal Rumble. Shinsuke Nakamura is very similar to Bobby Roode. I think that if Bobby... However... And people who watch my channel know I'm not big on Shinsuke Nakamura, and I don't believe that he is going to be big on the main roster. I believe he'll come up eventually, and maybe, depending on the situation, they may do a Finn Balor and give him the belt like right off the bat, but then he will disappear into obscurity because Vince McMahon does not like people who cannot talk on the mic, and Shinsuke does not speak English, so it's going to be an issue. Even if it's not an issue for the fans, it will be an issue for Vince McMahon, and that is why it will not work for him on the main roster. So, because of that, I think Triple H is being protective, and that even if Shinsuke loses to Bobby Roode, they will leave him in NXT to keep fighting for the belt a little more before they bring him up. I don't believe he instantly comes up to WWE, like Bobby Roode could. Now, even if he does stay in NXT, that doesn't mean he can't make an appearance at the Royal Rumble to gauge crowd reaction. That could happen. But I don't see him doing it as the NXT champion. So I think that the chance of Roode or Nakamura being in the Rumble is based on who loses the belt. And then which one it is. Because I think Roode has a better chance than Nakamura. Next is Roman Reigns and Kevin Owens. We do have precedent in the past for the loser of the championship match entering themselves in the Royal Rumble. You could say three of the spots go to Balor, Joe, and Kurt Angle, or whatever surprises they have, and two more spots go to Cena and Owens, or whoever loses the matches. And then the final three are Ellsworth, Cruz, and, you know, you could do that. That's not far-fetched or beyond. It doesn't happen very often, and you're asking people to double work the night. Now, the thing is, the people that could be going, Owens, AJ Styles, Roman Reigns, they are very, very much the type of people that could work twice in the night, especially if one of their things is working a Royal Rumble and, you know, just leaning against the rope for 20 minutes. So I do see them being all four of them, Owens, Cena, Roman Reigns, and AJ Styles, the next four in order on the list, all being potentials in there. But I don't, but only obviously the losers of the matches, and only I don't see any of them winning. I don't see John Cena losing to AJ Styles and then winning the Royal Rumble. I don't see Roman Reigns or Kevin Owens losing their match and then winning the Royal Rumble. So either way, they may be entered and will get them, will rank their potential for being there, but I don't see them as high potential to win it. The last two on there are Triple H, and the main reason he's on there is because he made a surprise entry last year. He's got a fight going with Seth Rollins. If Triple H is in the Royal Rumble, Seth Rollins could come down and eliminate him, causing that fight to happen. That's why he's on the list. Now, here's what I've got to say about that. First of all, we're going to start with why Triple H was in it last year. Last year, this build-up was Triple H versus Roman Reigns. Triple H doing everything in his power to take the title off of Roman Reigns, to keep the title from Roman Reigns. And the pay-per-view last year was for the title. The Royal Rumble winner was the champion. This year, the winner goes to WrestleMania to face the champion. It's a different situation. If Triple H enters and wins, he still has to go to WrestleMania and beat the champion to get the belt off them. First of all. Secondly, it's not his fight anymore. Seth Rollins is not the champion. So if Kevin Owens wins his match, Triple H winning puts Triple H versus Kevin Owens at WrestleMania, and that's his guy. He doesn't want to fight him. And if Roman Reigns wins it, it's a rematch from last year, but not what he cares about. So there's no driving force for him to enter the Royal Rumble this year. Secondly, I do agree that Seth Rollins has to be involved somewhere, somehow. He cannot sit the Royal Rumble out. He's not in the Royal Rumble. Maybe he beats someone up and takes their spot. I don't know what their plans are. I do see that putting Triple H in so that Seth Rollins can eliminate him at least gives Seth Rollins something to do, but I don't know why how they could justify putting Triple H in. He has no need to be in there. And that's a great point, and I will make that point after I talk about Ty Dillinger. Ty Dillinger is the last person on this list, and the reason why his name is on the list is twofold. First of all, everyone's rumoring him as being in the Royal Rumble, even if it's just for one night, and then showing, then being back in NXT just to test him out on the roster. But the thing is, his gimmick, 10, has expanded. It has made itself to the main roster. It has made itself to the European tournament. If you watched that European tournament, every time they were on the outside, everyone was chanting, 10, 10. Instead of count outs, instead of counting 1, 2, 3, they just chant 10 for every number of the count. His 10 is the new yes. It is as close to yes as we've seen in a while. And because of that, I feel that there's a chance they will test him on the roster in the Royal Rumble, even if they don't bring him up fully. Secondly, his storyline in NXT is, where do I go from here? What's the next step? I was not successful versus Bobby Roode. I was not successful in the number one contender match. What's the point of being here? What do I do next? And a lot of times, that storyline leads to a major shakeup in a character. Now, it could be, and they tease the him joining Sanity thing. Now, the thing with the Sanity coming out actually goes against the Royal Rumble thing for me, because that storyline would have played in good to bringing him the main roster. What's next for him is the Royal Rumble and on to SmackDown. But then why had him fight against Sanity? Why start a program as he's going up? So I don't think he's coming to the main roster. But a Royal Rumble appearance to help, you know, dip their toes in it to see, test the waters is not a bad idea. And everyone at this point expects him to come out at number 10. And I think it's kind of a dropped ball if he don't. So, I think it's a pretty good chance that he will be in the Royal Rumble. Now, people that aren't on this list that might make it into the Royal Rumble are people that are legends. We almost always see, and someone in chat just brought it to my attention, DDP last year. DDP is rumored to be one of the entries into the Hall of Fame this year. Could we be seeing DDP? Yes, but if I list every legend that could potentially go, the list would be ridiculously long. Plus, we don't see a lot of recurring ones. We see Kevin Nash one year, and then DDP the next year, and then Roddy Piper the next year, and then, so it's almost like which legend is still alive, could still make an appearance, but hasn't been in it, Scott Hall or something like that. So I feel like, yes, there will be a legend. That eight is going to include Ty Dillinger, Finn Balor, Samoa Joe, Apollo Crews, James Ellsworth, the two losers of the championship match, and one legend, which I don't know who it is. But I'm not going to speculate which legend it could be. It could be DDP. It could be Razor Ramon. It'd be really cool for him to dye his hair black and come out as Razor Ramon one more time. I think that'd be great. And theoretically, he's in better shape and ready not necessarily wrestling shape, but could he do a Royal Rumble one night for 6 minutes? I think he probably could. So we're not going to debate too much on that. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to quickly rank the chances of them being in the wrestle. And so let's quickly do WrestleMania. This is where the no one cares thing comes into play. All right. So what is Apollo Crews doing at WrestleMania? Doesn't matter. What is Bobby Roode doing at WrestleMania? Not main event. We don't know if he's going to be on the main roster at that point. We know he's not going to be in the main event. Enzo with Kaz. Finn Balor. This is something we need to take into consideration. James Ellsworth. Hopefully, let go. I'm over James Ellsworth. That was fun, but I'm done. I'm done with him. Now there's a good question too. Chat just said, Spec, do you think Lawler is in it? I read one rumor that says Jerry Lawler should be in it if he can handle it. He kind of started a program with Dolph Ziggler, letting him get in there. He could be the legend that's in it, yes. But I feel like Vince is overly protective of injuries nowadays, and Lawler with a heart attack, I'm not sure. Now, granted, if Lawler's going to fight anything, a Royal Rumble's the way to go. He comes in there and punches a couple people, and then gets kicked in the gut and put in a corner and held there until they throw him out. So it could happen. He could be the legend. I'm not sure I want it to be. I'm very protective of people too, and that would worry me. That would worry me. So I'm not going to put Lawler's name on it. But yes, he could be. They could definitely put Lawler in there. Omega, WrestleMania plans. New Japan Pro Wrestling? Question mark. Kurt Angle. We don't know, but not winning. But we'll do that. We don't know Samoa Joe. Shaquille O'Neal, Big Show, Shawn Michaels. Oh, did I skip Shawn? I skipped Shawn Michaels. Shawn Michaels' name has been rumored because he showed up on Wrestling TV, because it's in Texas. For those of you who don't know, I actually ran into Shawn Michaels at Disney World yesterday. I was in Disney World Orlando, and he was there with his family. Great guy. Took a picture with me. It was a lot of fun. I do not think Shawn will ever come out of retirement. There's been rumors of AJ Styles versus Shawn Michaels at WrestleMania. I mean, yeah, at WrestleMania. Again, Shawn could be playing the I'm going to tell you no, and so when it happens, it's a surprise. I just don't think that's going to actually happen. I don't see Shawn Michaels retired. I don't see him coming out of retirement for a Royal Rumble, much less a 3-month stint of Royal Rumble through WrestleMania. But I could be wrong. Shinsuke Nakamura, hopefully he'll still be in NXT. I don't see him coming up yet. Roman Reigns, WrestleMania, these guys, we don't know. We do know Kevin Owens in our world. He's fighting Chris Jericho. John Cena, we don't know. AJ Styles, we don't know. Triple H has Rollins. Ty Dillinger is still in NXT. So, because of that, we go, he'll be in NXT, so he's not going to win. He will be fighting Rollins, so he's not going to win. He'll be in NXT, so he's not going to win. He's retired, so he's not going to win. He is fighting Big Show, so he's not going to win. Well, yeah, not going to win, but we got to rank him. He's not in the Federation, so he's not going to win. He is not going to win. He does... Oh, there. With Kaz, he's not going to win because of with Kaz. And then, so these are the ones we need to rank. We kind of need to rank the zeros as well. The chances of these guys... the chances of these guys being in the Royal Rumble now. So we look and we say Finn Balor is the best chance. Of all the people, Finn Balor is the best chance. Then from there, I said Samoa Joe. And then I think at that point it becomes James Ellsworth. I think that those three are almost definitely in. Okay? And I'm going to make those green just so you see that those are ones that I am next to guaranteeing. From there, I think Ty Dillinger is a high chance. I think Cruz is over Dillinger, though. I think Cruz, then Dillinger. And then from there, it is probably Shaquille O'Neal. The loser, you know what? I'm going to make this one box. This just means whichever one loses. The loser of Roman Reigns, AJ Styles, John Cena, those... Just because I can't rank, you know, they'd be ranked the same. Roman or Kevin Owens. And then from there, it becomes Kurt Angle, Bobby Roode, actually, I think Kurt Angle, then Enzo, then Bobby Roode, then Shinsuke Nakamura, then Kenny Omega, and then Shawn Michaels. That's the order, and I'm going to sort this by the rankings. I'm going to sort that by there. You're going to make me have to work this, aren't you? All right, we're going to sort this real quick just so you guys can see my list in order. And then... There we go. Get that out. Put that there. That there. Oh, I forgot to rank Triple H. Got to rank Triple H. He is actually... Um, Let's see. I think he's after that. 9 is Enzo. 10 is Bobby. I think he's more likely than Bobby Roode. So 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Of the 14 people ranked, this is how I see it. Wait. 9, 10, 11, 15 people, I guess. 12, 13, 14, 15. So 8, 9, boom, 10, 11, through 15, boom. Properties, select that region, slide it up. Okay, there we go. So this is what I see. I feel like that is the chances, the potential. So because of that, I'm going to go and fill out the yellow. Now I'm going to fill out the yellow with, but I'm going to leave it yellow so you know that I'm saying 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That this is what I think, boom, those. And then the losers of the losers of the championship match. Now, from this, we see Balor, which would be facing Owens, or he would be facing either Owens or Reigns on Raw. Samoa Joe, I believe, would be SmackDown and would be facing either John Cena or AJ Styles. James Ellsworth has no chance in hell, so we won't even worry about that. Apollo Crews, again, no chance in hell, so we're not going to worry about that. Ty Dillinger, no chance in hell, we're not going to worry about that. And Shaquille O'Neal, no chance in hell, we're not going to worry about that. So what we're showing is that by doing this, we didn't gain any because the two guys that could win, that we don't, they could face either. It could be Joe versus AJ or Joe versus Cena, and you could do Balor versus Roman or Balor versus Owens. Now, and then these last two spots we have for the championship. Now, the whole point of this is everything we just did, and it does feed into the Royal Rumble, which we're going to discuss in a few minutes, but we're talking about the matches. We're talking about the championship matches. Now, I have to go into the Royal Rumble saying that one person, let's take this down for a second, one person, one of the titles is not changing hand. Now, everything I read from most of the stuff I've read has both titles changing hand. Roman Reigns is going to beat Owens, and John Cena is going to beat AJ Styles. John Cena gets his 16th championship, goes into WrestleMania as a champion, and defends against someone. Roman Reigns wins a championship, goes into WrestleMania, and defends against someone. That's how they have it play out. I'm not sure about that. And here's the thing. I feel it's going to be one title, not the other. And I haven't decided which one. I don't feel they changed both titles on this pay-per-view. So I have to start delving into the two outcomes and why they are and what changes and why they go the way they are. So let's start with the Raw one. And if we can figure out the answer to the Raw one, that'll give us the answer to the SmackDown one. Okay? So we have Kevin Owens versus Roman Reigns with the Shark Tank over their head with Chris Jericho in it. Now, I'm going to go back and say that I've brought up twice about stipulations. And stipulations are put in place like the steel cage for Becky Lynch and Alexa Bliss, like we've discussed about the two two refs in the tag team match for the championship tonight, Royal Rumble. Like the stipulation of, oh, maybe this is the third one that I was talking about. This one is in place because Jericho keeps making sure that Owens can't lose the title, so we're going to stick him in a shark cage to make sure he doesn't lose the title, or to make sure that he doesn't keep the title, so he doesn't make Kevin Owens keep the title, so Roman Reigns has a fair shot. That is what it's for. That's how the stipulation has been put into place. But the thing we need to understand is, when they put these stipulations into place, a lot of times, most of the time, whatever they're trying to prevent happens anyway. So on the surface, my base statement is, Owens has to keep the title, and Jericho's going to help him keep the title. If that's the case, and I've got more to say, and we're gonna fine tune this, we're gonna shift over to SmackDown. We're gonna say Owens stays the champion, which means Cena beats AJ Styles, Cena becomes the champion, and AJ moves on to something else. That is the most obvious, straightforward, what should happen statement. That, I mean, situation. I think it's going to flip. It's going to be the other way. And here's why. First of all, and we've discussed this in the past, to anyone who listened to me tell you how much better things would be and how much better things are when there are a brand split, this Royal Rumble is proof. This stuff does not happen when there is one title. When there is one title and you know who has it and who's going to be going for it, you don't have six or seven people who could possibly win the Royal Rumble. It just doesn't happen. You have to have two belts. You have to be able to say, this person can win it and go after John Cena, or that person can win it and go after Roman Reigns. You have to have that multiple belt option. And that is why this year is so unpredictable, because of the brand split. And I've been preaching that for years now, and I'm glad the brand split's back. What also it allows us to do is it allows us to have two Royal Rumbles. Now, I'm not saying two Royal Rumbles. That'd be nice. I actually said what they should do is they should have a Royal Rumble to start the show, a SmackDown 15-man Royal Rumble, and a Raw 15-man Royal Rumble to end the show. That would have been interesting. I'm not sure that it would have played out as good as I had hoped. But that's what I wanted to do, and have them both be done that way, at least for year one. But instead, what they did was they gave SmackDown's Royal Rumble, named the Elimination Chamber, in 2 weeks. Now, what I mean by that is, we're sitting here debating what 5 to 7 people could win the Royal Rumble. Sure, there are 30 people in there, but really, there's a list of 5 to 7 people that might win. There are 6 people that go into the Elimination Chamber. If SmackDown puts 6 people into the Elimination Chamber who could potentially win the title, you still have the same situation. If Raw did the Elimination Chamber and it was Brock Lesnar, Goldberg, Roman Reigns, Kevin Owens, The Undertaker, you know, then you have a situation where those still 6, anyone can walk out with a title, and you put one of them in the main event of WrestleMania, just like in the Royal Rumble. So, because that situation exists in 2 weeks, AJ Styles can win or at least retain his belt at Royal Rumble, and you can stick AJ in the Elimination Chamber with John Cena and 4 other people, and have John Cena win the Elimination Chamber and end up with the championship at WrestleMania, and it doesn't matter. Having the Raw title change hands at Fastlane is not as big of a deal. It's not as enjoyable, and it shaking up WrestleMania that close is not as good as shaking it up 2 weeks from now and still having a month or more to build on that storyline. Also, they're teasing. One of the rumors is AJ is going to fight Shane McMahon at WrestleMania. And if that's the case, AJ losing his belt to John Cena does nothing for that storyline. Whereas AJ losing his belt to John Cena at the Elimination Chamber because Shane McMahon put him in an Elimination Chamber versus 6 people to defend his title, that builds that story. So to me, from that perspective, you have to have AJ keep the belt and lose it to John Cena at the Elimination Chamber. Because of that, we can flip back over to the other side and say, well, then Roman has to win the belt here. Well, he doesn't have to. They could have no belt change hand. But if we go back to this little thing, we see that we have Kevin Owens fighting, and he's not in there. We have Chris Jericho fighting Kevin Owens at WrestleMania. At some point, we have to start building to that. Now,